So, good morning, everyone. So, sorry for the last 2 weeks. Yeah, they have some big grant from university, so I skipped 2 weeks. So today, we are talking about integrins. So, as you know, I gave you some one small task about our previous literature. So maybe you guys. Most of you guys draw the how and why they are linked together in terms of some inhibition or activation. So for the answer, you can write down in the final term exam, and then I will tell you what is the correct way. So this is your final task for the final term exam. So let's refresh your mind about the integrin, right? So this is a cell membrane, and then this is an inactive form of integrin. And as you know, integrin consists of alpha and beta form, and then this integrin especially they act as a catch and how can I say? Sorry. So this integrin act as a screen and catch. So which means that they always their basal level is inactive, and when they but they always try to catch something. They try to grab something, and then when they meet this kind of extracellular matrix, and then they finally catch and then bind. And then this is called how can I say unfolding. This is called unfolding. So unfolding means the folding is bending, right? So unfolding is reverse of the folding, so which means they can stand up. So if you see the term unfolding of the integrin, which means this is activate integrin. So un is sometimes they are used for adverse effect, but in this integrin form, you have to understand unfolding is active or integrin. So this is active. And then also the most important focal adhesion protein is TALEN. So basal level is inactive form, but when the integrin is unfolded, so now TALEN is activated. So they can attach to the edge of the integrin, especially beta. So always beta and active TALEN, they can connect each other. So this is the initial time point, and then over time, more focal adhesion complex is made by several proteins, as you know, vinculin, paxillin, maybe over 20 proteins you can imagine. And then now the global actin they can polymerize to F-actin, filament actin, right? So they can make their own structure. So let's imagine this is your cell, and you are the cell, and then you don't have any eyes. Just only way you can approach to the extra microenvironment is through the integrin. So integrin is kind of your eye. So your eye can touch something, and then they try to catch, grab, and then pull and push, and then when they feel proper force, and then they feel like, oh, it's time to make this kind of cytoskeleton to go forward or to move back or to attach or to differentiate into certain cell lineage. So this integrin is very important for tuning your cell fate. So this is called focal adhesion formation, and then Sometimes integrin and growth factor receptor can crosstalk. So let's imagine this is ECM and integrin, and this is the growth factor receptor, and then growth factor, when they are bind together, actually integrin is, we can call it another type of the receptor, but this is not binding with the growth factor, but this is only bind with extracellular matrix. So we can call it another type of the receptor, extracellular matrix receptor. So this growth factor receptor, extracellular matrix receptor, they can co-signal each other. So in a synergistical way, let's say this is some BMP, bone morphogenic receptor, and this is the bone morphogenic growth factor, they can bind together, and then they want to start to differentiate stem cell to the osteoblast lineage. In that way, the ECM can be stiff, and then this ECM stiffness can be felt by the integrin, and then actin, myosin contractility, they synergistically differentiate the stem cell to osteoblast. So let's imagine this is a human mesenchymal stem cell, and then if you want to differentiate to the osteoblast lineage, maybe bone morphogenic BMP, bone morphogenic growth factor, and then high stiffness, they can theoretically activate the mesenchymal stem cell differentiation. So, and then in another way, let's say nowadays Pinky is using chat to differentiate to the odontoblast, right? And then you can imagine what is the odontoblast differentiation growth factor. Let's say PDGF beta, and then you have odontoblast matched stiffness ECM, and then this kind of odontoblast matches stiffness, and then odontoblast favoring growth factor, they can theoretically behave each other, and then they can differentiate your shed cell to odontoblast. So if you think about to make the new material or new something, and then the initial approach is very important. Just if you only focus on ECM and integrin, it's not that fancy. Growth factor receptor, not that fancy. But if you consider these two points together, and then if you can design certain biomaterial or certain experiment, it will make your impact as a double. So always try to consider this kind of synergetic effect between them. And then another important thing is that, let's say a bone morphogenic growth factor, they need 1 milligram for differentiate mesenchymal stem cell to the osteoblast in vitro condition, let's say. But this 1 milligram, but this 1 milligram is very toxic in vivo, in clinical way. Because if we want to inject BMP in certain local system, what happens? This BMP is going to your brain, or it's going to your spinal cord. And then they can make exotic or inappropriate bone in other location, right? And then it's not good. So there is why FDA, they disapproved the BMP use in the orthopedic condition. BMP means BMP powder only. So they suggest try to use another material together, or try to conjugate the BMP in certain biomedical device. So the concept is that, so they want to decrease the BMP amount, like 10,000 times less, from 1 milligram to 1 microgram. And then what can be the next strategy? Is that if you can use 1 microgram of BMP, but go along with the integrin stiffness, and then this integrin and BMP 1 microgram can have similar effect to the 1 milligram of BMP. So from the clinical application, the biomaterial scientist or biomedical scientists, they just try to decrease the total amount of growth factor, along with they want to use this kind of mechanical transaction synergetic behavior. So you have to think about this kind of approach. So always in in vitro condition, if you treat BMP as much as possible, PDCF beta or insulin, IGF, more growth factor, most of the time, better result always. But in clinical way, it's not appropriate. You have to decrease as much as possible. And then how you can increase or maximize the growth factor receptor using small amount. And then this is through this stiffness matched integrin activation or cell-to-cell interaction, or maybe when this growth factor, they can conjugate in ECM, it will give you a good result. So when I talking about this growth factor and then ECM interaction, is that when just you culture the cell on certain ECM, and then when you treat the growth factor, this is not synergetically correct methodology. But if you conjugate growth factor inside or outside of ECM, and then the cell, they can simultaneously touch the ECM, they can feel the stiffness and certain component of ECM, as well as they can also meet the growth factor and activating this growth factor receptor. So you have to think about how you synergetically design your biomaterial in terms of this growth factor and integrin crosstalk. So let's say you have laminin, right? You have laminin. So laminin, they can be expressed in most of neural tissue. So and then they activate certain like alpha-3 beta-2 integrin. And then if you want to increase the differentiation of neural stem cell to neuron, and then the most basic concept is from the genetically way, you coat certain NGF to laminin and then make them as a membrane or a certain scaffold. And that is a very basic way to synergetically activate growth, neural induction growth factor, as well as neural tissue matched stiffness or component using the laminin. So yeah, please, if you design like this, the end point is very different. Just when you focus on only one, maybe impact factor 3 or 4, but when you consider these 2 points together, yeah, double, 6 or 7 and 10. Actually, this kind of approach is firstly mentioned in science paper, maybe 6, 7 or 8 years ago. So now biomedical scientists, they try to look at this point. Then, as you can imagine, this is some integrin and cell membrane and this ECM. So there are a lot of focal adhesion complex protein. So you just try to familiar with this kind of protein. Tallin, integrin beta, they attach. FAK, PIK2, SRC, GRB7, paxilin, vinculin, carbon, DLC1, tensin. Many kind of things are involved, maybe over 20s. And then you can think about why they need this kind of large amount or diversity of the focal adhesion protein, why they need. Actually, I don't have exact answer. Yeah. So people try to look at why they need this kind of large amount or huge variety of the focal adhesion protein. But maybe you can imagine, you are the creator of human beings. So why do you want to make this kind of diversity of the focal adhesion complex? Maybe, which means that each protein, they have certain each role, right? For example, vinculin, this is maybe they have certain role. Let's say in stiff condition, vinculin is more highly expressed in focal adhesion complex. But in case of, let's imagine GRB7, in soft stiffness, GRB7 is more prominently expressed in your cell. So this kind of approach is very important. So people try to look at what kind of component is important for certain condition. So if you, so you can ask yourself, okay, I can make three or four different stiffness, and then I want you to know from this different diversity of stiffness, what can be highly correlate to the stiffness from the focal adhesion complex protein. So if you find, like, let's say ALK, IRK, you try to look at 12 focal adhesion complex protein, or from the 12, ILK is highly correlate the increase of stiffness in terms of the expression. And then this is a very good study. And then if you knock down this ILK, maybe some can be replaced, or the stiffness sensing can be damaged. So if you prove this kind of concept through your material, which component is very important, and then let's say you have nanofiber structure, but you can make 1 micrometer nanofiber or 10 micrometer nanofiber, but depending on the microfiber, there is similar focal adhesion complex protein amount. But if I look at the individual expression, the styline is highly dominant in 10 micrometer nanofiber, and then this can be highlighted. Even though your result is similar, like nanofiber can make bone formation in calvaria, but if you find this kind of intracellular, subcellular mechanism through your platform, this can be nice. Okay? So that is why this lecture is just give you some fresh idea how you utilize this kind of small concept to your total study. So if you look at your textbook, there are written in many good theory, but most of the theory is not that perfect. So if you just try to point out, okay, just as a chance, I want to look at fact, or I want to know which kind of thing is involved in your system, and then this can be good. So anyhow, this focal adhesion protein complex, they can activate AKT, LOWROCK, MRC, and ARK and MAPK. Those are highly related to cell migration, adhesion invasion, proliferation, apoptosis, ENT. So this kind of endpoint is very simple. You can determine this kind of endpoint behavior simply. Just 1 year later of your in vitro work, you can do anything. But the initial focus, how and why this kind of focal adhesion complex is involved, and then how this your integrin and growth factor receptor can be complex, this is a very good initial point. And then this is from the physical protein complex, but if you look at this, only look at the FAK, so any kind of other signaling pathway can be involved. Some are can activate FAK. FAK is most important signaling pathway through the integrin and ECM communication. But PPL gamma, TJ beta, TPA, or other P10 or SOCS, they can inhibit. And then through this PY397 phosphorylation, they can also activate ARK, MAPK, PI3K, and AKT, which are highly involved in your cell metabolism or cell differentiation, cell fate. So through this study, so maybe you always try to culture your cell on the culture dish, right? So if you culture cell on the culture dish, every time the cell can sense your polystyrene dish substrate or their stiffness using the cell's integrin. Well, if you primary culture the shed cell or purple stem cell from the tissue or oral cancer cell tissue, also the first step is cell can migrate through the tissue to the polystyrene dish, and then they can touch. This integrin can touch the polystyrene dish. So you try, when you just subculture yourself, try to imagine, oh, this is time point when cell fill the polystyrene dish. And then you can increase your understanding. Yeah, almost similar, things. So yeah, ECM integrin always beta is connected with TALEN and actin is also polymerized. So this kind of PIPK gamma or PTDNSP2 that can activate TALEN integrin activation, formation of new titer. Titer means this, how can I say, how they attach. Yeah, so when they, this TALEN can attach to beta integrin, this can be tetering. So vinculin, they can form as a reinforcement. And the other focal adhesion protein also heavily activate through this mechanism. So if you look at the paper, they never draw just simply. They always know why this beta and TALEN is connect each other. They always try to draw based on their knowledge or their experiment result. So please try to look at this figure as much as detail possible. Also, if you look at this kind of things, maybe some good nature review paper, they consider the cell membrane size and integrin size, and then they can draw. But in this manner, I'm not sure they exactly match the size of the cell membrane and integrin. But if you believe like that, you can imagine, oh, this cell membrane, they're bilateral layer, like let's say 10 angstrom, but maybe integrin, they can 5 times length larger, and then oh, you can imagine how large the integrin receptor it is. So when you look at the integrin, they have a very diversity of the integrin set. So you have alpha and beta. Yeah, you only have alpha and beta, but from the alpha 1, 2, 3, 10, 11, E, blah, 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 and beta 1, 2, 7, 5, 4, 6, 7. So and then they try to search which kind of integrin is highly expressed in certain cell lineage or certain condition. So they can call it, one important thing is that you have to differentiate alpha 5, where is it, and alpha V. Actually, V is Romanian characteristic of the 5, right? But alpha 5, alpha V is totally different thing. So you have to differentiate. Alpha 5, alpha V is different one. So this collagen receptor, which means that when collagen ECM, when you culture your cell on collagen fiber, collagen cell membrane, what kind of integrin is highly expressed? Which is alpha 1, 2, 10, 11. Okay? And then you have some leukocyte receptor activated condition. Let's say your cell is hematopoietic stem cell or leukocyte, and then they are highly expressed this alpha E, D, L, M, and X. And then they can match with beta 2 and 7. Okay? Sometimes they can also activate alpha 4 and 9. And then they are also cross-linked to the heavily beta 1. So as you can see, beta 1 is the center of the integrin component. So most of the, so if you have a short time, like let's say you are under revision, but the reviewer asks you which kind of integrin can be involved to your substrate, your material, your system, and then the priority is checking the beta 1. Okay? Beta 1 is most basic integrin component. And then let's say after checking beta 1, according to your ECM component, collagen, your cell type, leukocyte, or if you have RGD receptor and laminin, like neural tissue, you can simply check, okay, I coat the laminin in nanofiber and then culture the neural stem cell, and then you don't need to look at the other receptor, other integrin, just only look at beta 1, alpha 3, beta 1, alpha 6, beta 1, alpha 7, or beta 4, alpha 6, something like. If you have RGD receptor, RGD is, you can coat directly, or if you coat with fibronectin, or most of the cell adhesive protein, they can combine, they can include this RGD. sequencing in your structure, protein structure. So you can detect alpha 5 beta 1, alpha V beta 1, and any kind of subcellular type can be involved. So, if you look at the Wikipedia, you can look at it. Distribution and then ligand. Ligand means distribution means where you collect. When you look at this integrin set, which tissue or which cell are highly expressed. Let's say hematopoietic stem cell, they can highly express alpha 4 beta 1 compared to other integrin set. You cannot say alpha 4 beta 1 only expressed in HSC, but other integrin also expressed, but highly expressed in HSC cell, alpha 4 beta 1. And what happened alpha 2 beta 1? Also, they can be expressed, but much lower than alpha 4 beta 1. And then this hematopoietic stem cell, when they express alpha 4 beta 1, ligand means fibronectin and alpha 4 beta 1 is meet each other from the hematopoietic stem cell. Or FreeCAM1, alpha 4 beta 1 can match from the hematopoietic stem cell. Hematopoietic stem cell, when they attach on the cell culture dish, let's imagine. Actually, hematopoietic stem cell, they never attach. So let's say epithelial cell. You can collect the skin tissue from the human beings, and then primary culture, and then you just culture the epithelial cell on the dish, okay? And then they highly spread alpha 6 beta 4 through this epithelial cell. They can secrete the laminin by themselves, okay? So this kind of ligand, also this is can be secreted from your cell, donor cell. And then epithelial cell, first time they just attach through one of the disintegrin or all kind of disintegrin. And then when they secrete their proper appropriate ECM, like laminin, and then they highly express alpha 6 beta 4. Why? Because the cell can feel happiness when they attach on certain ECM through this alpha 6 beta 4. That is why they want to secrete laminin, like this. And then let's say your red MSC. Red MSC, they attach, first try to approach the cell dish, and then I'm not sure, they first attach and then secret ECM, or they secret ECM simultaneously and then attach. So anyhow, they want to secret collagen or laminin simultaneously when they're attaching on the dish. And then they express highly alpha 1 beta 1. Okay? So, and then it will take some time to attach this kind of cell and then your culture dish, like 30 minutes, let's say. But in dynamic human body, the blood fluid is very fast, and then you try to catch the stem cell as much as possible in a very short time, right? And then when you coat collagen in advance, before being secreted from your target cell, what can be happening? The cell can attach better, attach fast, and then you can accelerate some cell attachment on your appropriate biomaterial, and then it can increase the cell tissue regeneration speed, right? So there is why biomaterial scientists, they want to coat certain appropriate cell adhesive protein or peptide into your material to accelerate, to fast the speed of adhesion. And then you want to focus on immune cell. And then you have two strategies. First one is I want to quickly pass the immune response. And then you just you can coat some immune cell favoring ligand. What can be the immune cell favored ligand? Let's say T-lymphocyte, you can imagine. And then you can coat your fiber with ICAM-1 and ICAM-2. And then T-lymphocyte more favorably attach on your substrate. And then you can manipulate or you can change the T-lymphocyte behavior using this coating. But in another way, you do not want to T-lymphocyte attach your fiber. And then you can coat like ICAM-1 antagonist, or when you coat something, ICAM-1 is not binded to your substrate, you can use that strategy. So you can hear about some butterfly effect, right? So when butterfly, they can move in the west side of your territory, but east side, this butterfly movement, they can make huge typhoon, right? So that's why, as a very initial cell and ECM or biomaterial interaction, the very initial moment is very important. So initial moment is can be mediated by immune cell or stem cell. And then this kind of consequence result can affect the final outcome of the tissue regeneration. So that's why biomedical scientists, they want to look at what kind of integrin is involved to your material. And then if you can make new synthesized chemical or material, and then try to use it in biomedical application, so basic thing is that you have to look at what kind of integrin is mediated for when cells are attaching on your designed material. So for proving the concept, we have integrin inhibitor and primer for QPCR list. So human integrin primer, we have alpha 5 and beta and beta 1, 2, 3. This is our library. So please remember what kind of integrin primer we have for human. And like this, you can design by yourself for mouse and rat. Okay. And then we have functional antibody of integrin 1, beta and 6 and beta 1, 2, 3. Okay. So what is the functional antibody? So this is your cell. So you want to see the cell on your appropriate biomaterial. And then you want to know which kind of integrin can be mediated for cell to attach on the substrate. And then basic thing is that you treat alpha 1 functional antibody, which means let's say this is alpha 1, and then if you alpha 1 functional antibody, and then you can, this kind of cap is cover the alpha 1 integrin. And then after 30 minutes of incubation of functional antibody, and then if you see the cell to the substrate, alpha 1 is not activated because they cannot touch the substrate, because we already cover the alpha 1 head using alpha 1 functional antibody. And then we can find out the load of the alpha 1. Okay, I will show you later how we can do the design. So this is called attachment inhibition assay. Let's say you have this kind of cell number and pre-incubate the 5 millimole EDTA, 500 micromole magnesium chloride, and 500 microgram ml heparin, or 10 microgram per ml functional blocking antibody against the integrin set of alpha 1, 2, 3, 6, beta 3 for 15 minutes at 37 degrees. So you can imagine what is the role of EDTA, magnesium chloride, heparin, or functional antibody. And then after pre-incubate cell were transferred, moved to the plate, culture plate, they were coated with your appropriate, this time, Vimentin 16, another type of the steroid adhesion protein, and incubate for 1 hour for checking initial attachment, and quantify the attached cell amount. So you guys will understand this approach, right? You can imagine. So for understanding, I'm going to briefly introduce this paper, Cell Death and Differentiation. So they are using human vitronectin-derived peptide, and then they want to check the peptide promote oxygen cell adhesion and migration. Actually, this peptide is quite long, but they can segment this peptide part 1, part 2, part 3. Okay? And then after they synthesize part 1, part 2, 3, they confirm the size and using Western blot, and then they quote the different concentration of part 1, 2, 3, and then they check the cell adhesion. So as you can see, part 3 yellow, very low, part 2 green, high, part 1 red, high, part 1 green, more highly attached, over increase of concentration. Okay, so this is individual vitronectin peptide adhesion effect to the oxygenic cell, and then you want to confirm compared to total vitronectin. From total vitronectin, part 1, part 2, part 3, part 1 is most highly cell adhesive ability they have, right? And in terms of cell area, also they can decrease a little bit, but almost similar. Cell migration speed decreasing, but other things they never happening. But only part 1 of vitronectin, they are increase of cell migration. And then maybe just vitronectin is consist of part 1 to 3, but when they are 3 are combine them together, they are first priority. But if I want to use just only part 1, also I can 80 or 90% capacity of vitronectin I can acquire, right? And then they want to decide to use this part 1 vitronectin. You can ask why we should not use vitronectin for sequencing. It's not easy to make vitronectin for sequencing by a synthetic manner. So most of vitronectin, they are derived from the pig or other kind of tissue. So it's not easy to apply in clinical application. So that is why you want to minimize the peptide sequencing. So they want to look at what kind of short peptide or maximize amount peptide sequencing you can acquire. And then they look at, like we observed before, they want to co-culture the osteogenic cell, let's say red MSC, and then none, without anything. This is 100%. And then you can co-culture red MSC and EDTA together, 15 minutes, pre-incubate it, and then see this cell, pre-incubate cell, to the culture dish. But nothing, almost nothing adhered. Okay? In magnesium chloride, somehow they increase cell attachment. Heparin, nothing changed. So what is the meaning of this one? Heparin is proteoglycan receptor, like Syndecan. So when the heparin is pre-incubate your cell, which means this kind of proteoglycan receptor, they are blocked. So when the heparin interferes with heparin, the cell adhesion is nothing changed, which means heparin cannot block the cell adhesion, which means proteoglycan receptor, even they are blocked by heparin, the cell attachment behavior is not changed. So this vitronectin coating is not vitronectin coating, and cell adhesion is not mediated by proteoglycan receptor. In another way, EDTA, if you look at this kind of integrin in detail, integrin always in the central area, they have calcium or magnesium ions. They need positive charged ion for stabilizing the integrin set. So that is why when you use EDTA, EDTA is a chelating of the calcium and magnesium ions, so they are removing all kind of this stabilizer in the integrin set. So if you pre-incubate the EDTA with your red MSC, they are losing their integrin formation. So That is why they have less cell adhesion. And then we can say that, oh, some integrin mediated cell adhesion is important in vitronectin part 1 coated culture dish. Okay. And then what is the magnesium? Magnesium is an enhancer for stabilizing the integrin set. That is why they are more highly upregulated. So these two decrease of EDTA cell adhesion, increase of magnesium chloride, they can display that integrin is mediated in MSC and vitronectin part 1 coated dish. Okay? But nothing related to the proteoglycan receptor. And then they want to check which kind of integrin is involved. Okay? And then this is a negative, this kind of control group for this Holter assay. And then, like I mentioned, they block alpha 1 antibody, they pre incubate alpha 1 function antibody 15 minutes, and then see this cell to the vitronectin coated dish. But nothing changed. But only beta 1 is changed, decreased, which means that when we block the beta 1, the cell cannot attach the vitronectin part 1 coated dish, which means beta 1 is mediated, right? So that's why they confirm, oh, beta 1 can be involved. So, what is the figure C? Yeah. And then, beta 1 integrin. So, cell, this is from the CCK data, and the relative cell density also decreasing in beta 1 integrin inhibitor. And cell attachment percentage also decrease. And then, this is some IP. So they just collect vitronectin part 1. The VMP16 is vitronectin part 1. And then they want to really look at when they just say you culture the cell on the vitronectin part 1, like 1 hour, and then you collect the vitronectin only. So if vitronectin is really, they can mediate the cell adhesion through the beta 1, you can detect the beta 1 in the vitronectin, right? Because vitronectin, beta 1 of cell, integrin, they should physically connect each other, if our notion is correct. So this is some endpoint study experiment to confirm this kind of vitronectin 16 is really mediated by beta 1 of your integrin. So, yeah, from the whole cell lysate means total cell protein. So beta 1 is similarly you can detect, but when you collect the VMP16 protein. But this is you try to collect same amount of VMP16, but only beta 1 is detected in this manner. So you can imagine this is some normalization. So this bar intensity can show you load the same amount of the beta 1 integrin protein. Okay? Almost similarly, you load the beta integrin. And then through that, when you only collect the VMP16, this beta 1 is only appear in here using this pull down assay. So this is a perfect confirmation this beta 1 is involved in that system. So if we want to look at more detail, you can check this cell death differentiation in this paper. They simply and very nicely describe how you confirm which kind of integrin is mediated. So this is some time point of the when and how the integrin is activated. This is a time scale. Resting cell, tissue ligation, integrin activation from inside out, integrin beta tail phosphorylation, and mature integrin set. So you can imagine only, let's say, 30 seconds to 5 minutes, 5 to 10 minutes, and then they are matured, okay? Which means maximum is 30 minutes. So if you want to look at some integrin, 5, 10, 20, 30 minutes. Maximum is 1 hour. But over 1 hour, 2 hours, no meaning. Most of the time, right? But this is when your cell is perfectly attached on your substrate, maybe less than 30 minutes is okay. But if you have very hydrophobic material, or you try to see the cell, but their cell is not happy when you look at by SEM or following DAPI, they're not spreading that much, even after 1 or 4 hours, and then you can determine the time point. So anyhow, before looking at which kind of integrin experiment, integrin cell is involved, you first look at the cell morphology. Maybe within 30 minutes, cell are spread totally. Spread means when their cell are not spreading, they are maintain their round shape. But when they are spread, they are just like flattened. So after 4 hours, the cell just maintain their round shape, which means cell cannot favorably attach on your substrate. And then you can determine time like 2 hours or 1 hour for checking integrin. But after 30 minutes later, when you observe the cell are totally spreading, you have to looking at more early time point, like 1 minute, 5 minute, 10 minute. Okay? So yeah, actually this is kind of another like immune cell, so that is why they can mention TCR ligation or IKM1 binding. But I want you to look at what is the appropriate time point for checking the integrin set. So for utilizing this kind of integrin inhibition assay, so we fabricated polyurethane biopolymer. We literally newly synthesized this polyurethane using PCL or PCL plus diocyanate and then IC59, some kind of chemical structure. And then we can make polyurethane. Polyurethane is kind of very flexible, and then which can be used for muscle regeneration because they are very elastic or flexible. And then, interestingly, we want to compare the cell adhesion using 5 different cells, and then PCL and ISBP, which is our favorite polyurethane. As you can imagine, compared to PCL, as you know, which is FDA approved, compared to PCL, ISBP, they are highly cell attached, right? Compared to PCL. And this is a very dramatic result because most of the polyurethane, they always have lower cell adhesion ability compared to PCL. But here, somehow, we fortunately make the new polyurethane, but they have very powerful cell adhesion ability. And then, what can be the next step? You can make your new material, and then you prove, oh, cell adhesion is very good. And then you can ask yourself, which kind of integrin is mediated? So we do functional antibody test through alpha-1 and control. And then through the cell area, let's say control alpha-1, similar to just very similar, but except alpha-5, right? Alpha-5, they are highly diminished, the cell adhesion area. So other thing is similar, but alpha-5 can be mediated. So we can say that in this kind of newly synthesized polyurethane, the cell MSC can attach very well on this polyurethane through alpha-5 integrin. So when you can say this kind of, okay, many people just say cell adhesion is good because I can make this kind of new polymer. And then you have to ask one deeper, what kind of integrin? Alpha-5, okay. And then next step is, if you alpha 5 using siRNA, if you block the alpha 5, knock down alpha 5, the cell adhesion ability is decreased. And this is a 100% sure experiment. Okay. So yeah, this is a very good Nature Review molecular cell biology paper. So I'm gonna, maybe some of them you already familiar with this kind of integrin story, but for increasing your memory, I'm gonna share one review. So you can imagine from the nucleus transcription, and then ER, and then Golgi formation, you can make this kind of new integrin form at inactive dimer. And then they can somehow just stay flow on the cell membrane, right? So free diffusion is that they just flow. And then somehow when they meet appropriate ECM, and then they can catch, and then they can unbind, right? And then at the same time, TALEN is also activated, and they can attach the beta integrin, FAK, and other focal complex they can involve. Okay? So this is called conformational change from the bending to unbinding, right? And then through strong ligand binding. And then there, let's say this one, but they can, you can make three focal adhesion maturation, and then they can make affectin and other focal adhesion complex. And then also from certain way, TALEN to switch to the tensin in certain condition. So there is a way why you want to look at which kind of focal adhesion is involved. Maybe TALEN, there is initial adhesion or actin filament formation. But when you need some kind of special tension or special behavior of cell, they need the change of the focal adhesion to TALEN to tension. Okay? Switch from TALEN to tension. So you can imagine, okay, this is a one integrin. This is three integrin. Maybe you can imagine certain reason why they draw three integrin here. Because let's say you are one integrin, they can endure 10 newton. But the cell wants to go forward. But they need more power, right? So that is why they need more focal adhesion and more integrin set to increase their power. So that is why they need three compared to one. And then this kind of force also, they can highly pressured. So the blue density is increased here. And then, okay, they do their way. And like one day later, they feel like, oh, integrin is not, actually it's time to say goodbye to integrin. And then what happened? Receptor endocytosis. And then integrin also, they can recycle through this kind of manner. Okay? So, and then this integrin set also can be involved many kind of clustering-dependent endocytosis, carbolyone internalization, and clustering-independent carrier like galactin 3. This is to show how the integrin can be endocytosis for recycling through this receptor endocytosis or clustering is some another subcellular component of the endocytosome. And then carbolyne 1 is also another one. And then clustering independent carrier like galactin 3 is another glycophenolipid is another type of submolecule. So people can understand, okay, integrin can be recycled in the endosome. And then people want to know, maybe alpha 2 or beta 1, they are mostly recycled through receptor and cytosis. But alpha 3, beta 2, they are specially endocytosis by clustering dependent endocytosis. So if you can reveal this kind of subcellular finding, this can be good. Okay? And then for that, you have to confirm, oh, integrin is recycled, confirmed by certain experiment. And then, which kind of mechanism is involved? And then we have clathrin-dependent inhibition chemical, carbonyl-1 inhibition chemical, this galactin-3 inhibition chemical, receptor-insert inhibition chemical we have in itran. So you can determine which kind of internalization pathway can be involved. So, like we mentioned, this integrin, they always communicate the ECM stiffness, right? So when this binding force is high, the force and force binding, bonding. So force, outer force and force bonding is equal, and then bone lifetime is good. They are highly maintained. But the force outside is over the force binding. Let's say ECM is stretched or they are fluctuated. But force binding is not enough to catch this ECM, and then they can detach. And then this binding lifetime can go down. But if your binding force is less than, higher than force, also the bond lifetime is not that high much as this kind of middle system. Okay, and then, like you mentioned, this is how the integrin is inactive form to active form and then unfolding, right? Unfolding and catch and bond behavior, they can maintain. And then, more clustering. Also, you also imagine, more clustering can give you less force experience by individual integrin molecule. If you have only three, this force is over your binding force of integrin, and then this ECM and integrin can detach, right? That's why, so the integrin, the cell, they want to decrease the experience force in individual integrin, so they need more integrin, right? And then, other kind of glycolics, and then the cell membrane fluctuation, also they can manage the integrin numbers or integrin diversity. And then finally, this kind of stiffness, high stiffness and low stiffness, they can mediate the integrin behavior. So let's say this is a normal situation, YAPTAS, affecting and few integrin are mediated. But when the ECM is induced by higher force through increase of stiffness like cancer development, fibrosis, or stretch, they can give you more integrin set because the integrin, they can increase their number to make equal amount of the force between ECM and the integrin, and then they can make more actin filament. And then now, YAPTAS can go inside of nucleus. So this is the force transmission to the nucleus via ectomyosis contractility. And then this kind of all things we already explained in previous one. Yeah. The more force, they can give you more force per individual integrin set, and they can more stabilization, more numbers, and then TALEN is mediated. So soft and stiff, yeah. So now this kind of pulling on the ECM, you can imagine, soft, ECM is very soft, so they need small amount of integrin set. But in high stiffness, always the cell try to catch and bond, and they pull down, pull out. So they need force to catch the ECM, so they need a high number. And then even in the ligand density. When they have high ligand density, they have more attachment between integrin and ECM. But when they have low ligand density, they have less chance to attach on ECM and integrin set. So even though your cell itself, they want to fully attach on this ECM, but they don't have enough amount of ligand, and then in that time, the stiffness is more increased, where when you just stretch it, the cell can detach, because the integrin per the force per integrin set is over the ECM and integrin bonding force, so they can detach. And then the cell, they try to secrete more cell adhesive protein to maintain, to increase the cell and ECM binding, because cells are always dynamic, right? So, and then why we need more ligand in biomedical scientists? Because this initial point, cell interaction, can mediate the total outcome of the tissue regenerative property. And then, yeah, let's say this, when force are loading, this low density of ligand, high force load per integrin, so this color is more dense in here. And when force is more loaded, mechanosensing is triggered and adhesion grows until force per integrin is restored. But when force is loaded, this average force per integrin, they can be maintained, right? And then mechanosensing is not triggered, and then adhesion does not grow. So which means they already have four integrin set. Even though force is loaded, these four integrin, they can endure the force. So there is the actin filament is not propagate to the force delivery, and then there is no other integrin set. But here, when they have less, they can make more integrin set like this. And then when you look at this phenomenon, you want to highlight the stretch force, how the stretch force can mediate the integrin increase. And then what can be the right way? You have to increase the integrin, initial integrin amount, initial high ligand density, or you have to minimize the ligand density for maximizing stretch or external force mediated integrin different behavior. The answer is you have to minimize the ligand density to show the potential of the outer force, how they increase the integrin numbers. Okay? Pinky, do you get it? So always more ligand is not good. Based on your experiment design, if you want to focus the external force can increase the integrin numbers, and then you have to minimize the coating amount of your fiber. But yeah, so you try to deal with this kind of little tricky concept for making your experiment. Okay, do you guys have any questions?